session 6 of Mind the Gap. You're almost there. We just have 2 weeks left this week and next week of the series. How's it going so far? Do you feel yourself growing? Do you feel challenged? If you're like me, you don't have any problem feeling challenged. You see all of those gaps. And I just want to encourage you and remind you that what we're doing is we're seeking the Lord as we press into Him, as we press into this area of growing in the gaps. We're doing it in His strength and not just ours. We're asking Him, Lord, would you help me? Would you help me grow? Would you help me learn? Would you help me say yes to you? We make the tough decision, but we do it to honor Him and ask, and as we're doing it, we're asking Him, please, would you help us? And He will strengthen us and make that possible. Now, today's session, session 6, is about purity. We're going to talk about the purity gap. And then in our verse, 2 Peter 1:6, the section here says, and to steadfastness with godliness. Godliness. How do we act like God? What is godliness? Godliness is actually that idea of holiness and purity. And it's the way that we're called to live as believers. In your notes there, right there at the top, a gap, any gap between our character and the character of Christ is a gap in our purity. Now, I know that there are many gaps in my purity, because when I look at Christ, who is the perfect example, I very quickly, as I compare my life to His, I very quickly begin to see, man, there's a lot of shortcomings. There's a lot of ways that I'm missing it. Perhaps it's issues with my mouth and the things that I say, the thoughts in my heart, not only the things that I do, which are out of line, but just the very way that I, the attitudes that I carry, all of those things. Anytime we're out of line with the character of Christ, they're gaps in our purity level, and we're actually called to be more like Him. 1 Peter 1, verse 15 says, but just as He who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, be holy because I am holy. So as believers, we're called to holiness. We're called to purity. We're called to be like Christ. 1 John 2:6, whoever claims to live in Him must live as Jesus did. Now this seems like an impossible thing, I think, when we really get to it, because we see all of the gaps in our ability to be like Christ, we almost want to give up. And yet what we have to remember is that by His Spirit, He is enabling us to change and to be different and to close that gap in purity. You know, the Holy Spirit was with Jesus Christ as He walked on the earth, and it was through the power of the Holy Spirit that Jesus resisted temptation. It was through the power of the Holy Spirit that He was kept pure, and you too have that same Spirit. You and I, all who have Jesus Christ, if you know Him and you're saved in Him, you've been washed by Him, then you have received His Holy Spirit, which can enable you to be like Jesus. So you can actually say no to sin and say yes to Him. Look at the guidance section there. Let's just talk a little bit about our call as believers to be more like Jesus in this area of purity. Number one, every believer is called to holy living. And we said that already. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 3, God's will is for you to be holy. So stay away from sexual sin. Then each of you will control his own body and live in holiness and honor, not in lustful passion like the pagans do, who do not know God and His ways. You and I, as followers of Jesus, we're actually called to grow in our holiness, to grow in our level of purity. We're supposed to be walking farther and farther away from the things that make us impure. Now, in this world, there are so many things that make us impure all the time. It's so easy for us to get tripped up. That's why Scripture talks about, a New Testament a lot talks about sexual sin in particular, how easy it is for us just to get dirty. We walk around, and our own culture just doesn't help us here in this regard, right? It offers to us, even the very ways that it sells things to us, it's so frequently calling to our lower lustful nature. It's so frequently stirring up desires inside of us that are not pure. And if we were to add to that just the reality that it's not only just the very things that we do, but the thoughts inside of our heart, it just, the gap seems so impossible, right? When we listen to Jesus and He talked about purity, He said things like, boy, you know, you think you're doing good because you haven't murdered anyone, but the reality is if you've murdered someone in your heart, then you're guilty of murder, right? He says, you think you're doing well because you haven't ever committed adultery against your spouse, But the reality is if you have a thought that is impure, a thought of adultery, then it's the same as if you have committed adultery. It just seems impossible. I mean, the gap just seems ridiculous. And yet, we're called to live different. We're called to walk more and more like Jesus. And so we don't just give up. We don't just say, well, there's no way I can ever be like that. And I think sometimes we're tempted to do that, right? We're just tempted to almost like excuse ourselves for the sin that is in our life. And we just say, oh, well, you know, I messed up again. Well, yeah, you did mess up again, but there's also a calling for us to be different, to do it different next time, to say, you know what, that is sin, actually, what I did, and I was a willing participant, and yes, I was tempted, and yes, I fell, and yes, and this and that, but that's not an excuse. We're actually going to move forward, and so God, would you forgive me, and now I'm going to turn the other way. I'm going to walk differently. I'm not going to just keep falling into the same sin over and over again, but I'm actually going to walk out of it in your strength and your mercy. I may fall again. I anticipate that as a person that lives in this world, that's going to happen, but I'm not going to actually plan to do it. I'm not actually going to just excuse my sin. I'm going to actually choose a different way. Number two there, becoming more like Christ is a process called sanctification. And that's what we want to remember, is that we are in process. We are growing into a new creature. God is working something inside of us. This is not like I've made a decision, I'll never mess up again. No, this is we're changing little by little, day by day, becoming more and more like Jesus. 2 Corinthians chapter 3 says, so all of us who have had that veil removed can see and reflect the glory of God. Now, what are we talking about? The veil. The veil is the veil of sin. When we are in sin, when we don't know Christ, when our spirit hasn't been renewed prior to receiving Him as Lord and Savior of our lives, we have a veil, the spiritual veil that's over our eyes, and we cannot actually see the Lord. But now that we have the veil removed, right, we can see and reflect the glory of God. And the Lord, it says, who is Spirit, makes us more and more like Him as we are changed into His glorious image. More and more like Him. That process, we give it kind of a fancy word called sanctification. Now, the difference between two biblical concepts that are important for us to understand, the difference between sanctification and justification, you might write that down, I don't think I have it in your notes. Sanctification is the process of us changing little by little, becoming more like Christ. Justification is a legal fact that God has declared over us when we are in Christ Jesus. He has made us justified before Him so that we are perfect in Christ. We no longer have to pay the penalty of sin because Christ has paid the penalty of sin and He has justified us, right? Whenever sin is committed, whenever the law is broken, the law is due to be paid. Somebody has to make things right. Christ came and made things right. He justified His people. He paid the ultimate price with His sacrifice. And because of that, His blood has covered us and it has made us right with God. So that's why we can say in full confidence, Lord, I'm perfect in You. Thank You for Your covering. That's why we can go into the Lord's presence, because Jesus is covering us and He's justifying us, right? But that doesn't mean that we are perfect yet. Now, from His perspective, right, because of the covering of Jesus, we are perfect before Him. But from our perspective, we recognize and see there is still a process that's going on. So that as we grow more and more to be like Christ, we are then living more and more like Him, looking like Him. The gap is closing. And so that when He looks at us, He is both seeing us as perfect, but seeing us as growing into perfection so that we can become more like Him. Both of those are really critical and important. One should not be used as an excuse for sin. Sometimes we can use justification as an excuse to go on sinning. But the reality is justification, we're so grateful for. We say, thank You, God. I want to be more like You, just as a thank you to You, as a worship, to be actually more and more like You is the one of the ways I want to just say, thank You, Jesus, for making a way for me. Thirdly, there in your notes, sanctification is about becoming a person with new desires, not only doing the right things. And so we're not just talking here about just making sure you never say a bad word, or making sure you never do something with your hands that you shouldn't do, look at something you shouldn't look at. We're actually talking about changing from the inside out. And it's actually possible, and parents know this, it's possible for you to control your kids, particularly when they're little. You can control their bodies, but not actually touch their hearts. You can control what they do, but who they are on the inside can be something different entirely. The process of sanctification is not just about the outside, is actually about changing who we are on the inside, because that's where our life flows out of. That's really why we make the decisions we make, is the inside always is coming outside. Matthew chapter 23, what sorrow awaits you, teachers of religious law and you Pharisees, you're hypocrites, for you are so careful to clean the outside of the cup and the dish, but inside you are filthy, full of greed and self-indulgence. You blind Pharisees, first wash the inside of the cup and the dish, and then the outside will become clean too. Jesus looked at those teachers of the law. They were really good. They were almost perfect in their behavior. They followed the law, the Old Testament law, to the T. They had it all figured out. And they were so dedicated to living correctly that they forgot to actually change what was happening on the inside. And Jesus saw right through it. And the Father does as well. He sees right through all of our attempts just to be good, to prove ourselves, to follow every dot and cross every T. He actually sees beyond that to the desires and the internals of our heart. And that's what we truly want to seek to be transformed in. Because if our desires grow in Him and towards Him, then we will find the natural outflow of our life will change as well. So it's not just slapping down bad behavior. It's about changing our heart and our desires and why we're doing things. It's the why, not just the what. Actually, the why is so critical in the kingdom of God, because the why speaks of the heart. Why do you do what you do? That's why it's so important for us to actually go deeper than just dressing up on the outside, looking good on the outside. It's actually saying to God, God, there's something inside of me that is always reaching out for that which is terrible and sinful. And God, I don't want to just control my behavior. I don't just want to say no. I want to actually want to say yes to you. I want to run from sin. I want to not anymore hunger for things that are unrighteous. And that's the pursuit that we're invited into in this life of closing the gap in the area of purity. Number four there in your notes, sanctification is a work of the Spirit through an obedient heart, an obedient heart. Romans 12, don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. It's that obedient heart that God desires. It's the transformation of who we are truly on the inside. No one else can see it, perhaps, other than ourselves and God Himself. And as we continue to be obedient, as we continue to learn to lean on Him and to say yes to Him, then there's something deep, a deep work that happens. Let me just leave you with an illustration, and then I'll pray for you, send you into your discussion. In this area of transforming our behavior, we must remember this is not just an outside thing, this is an inside thing. And sometimes if we have been in the church for any amount of time, or if we grew up in a home where we learned external self-control, it's actually easy for us to act right. Some of us are actually really good at acting right. I can act pretty good. I can control my mouth almost in every situation, right? I can stand up and make sure that I guard my face and my looks, and I know how to act in church and outside of church as well. It's fairly easy at this point for me not to commit sin in those external ways in front of people, certainly. But the reality is that the more you take care of the outside, the more the opportunity to take care of the inside really begins to present itself. Because we don't kill sin by just doing the right thing. We only kill sin by really taking our heart to the Lord. There's a man, it said, a story of he walked across America, a journey of many, many miles. And they asked him afterwards, what was the most difficult thing about his journey? And you would think, you know, maybe it was the long roads or a particular mountain or some obstacle that he faced. And he said, you know, the most difficult thing was the sand in my shoes. Sand in my shoes. Sometimes it's the smallest things that are the most difficult. The smallest things that can really trip us up and we find ourselves slowed down by and irritated by. You know, you can take care of the big things, right? Not murdering, not killing, not committing adultery perhaps. But what about the small things? Those small ways where we're not obedient, the attitudes of our heart, in the quietness of ourselves when we curse someone in our heart or in our mind, or we begin to contemplate things that are not what God's purposes are. It's like sand in our shoes, and we recognize more and more that those things are as important, even maybe more important than the external things. That's getting down to the nitty-gritty. That's the thing that God really wants to change. Wherever you're at in your purity gap, I want you to know that there's farther to go. That Jesus will begin to deal with you perhaps on a large scale. And then as you begin to become more and more obedient and you get to go closer and closer to Him, you start to see, oh my goodness, there's so many ways that I'm out of line and so many ways that He has still to work on me, my attitudes and my insides and my thoughts and the very secrets of my heart. Oh God, would you change us? Would you make us more like you? Let me pray for you and send you to discussion. Jesus, in this area of purity, we see certain things so clearly, and others perhaps it takes us a little time. I just pray, God, that you would, by your Holy Spirit, you just whisper to each and every one of us, first of all, that you love us, you've accepted us, you've forgiven us, and you've justified us. But secondly, that you're calling us to come closer to you, that there's actually change that needs to happen. And that you're willing to work with us. Lord, help us to be actually full of repentance in our hearts, sorrow for the sin that we are committing, even in a regular way. And Lord, we just pray that you would then call us into a different kind of life. Holy Spirit, would you make our desires more like your desires? Would you change us from the inside out as we seek you to fill this gap of purity. In Jesus' name, amen.